Good afternoon, everybody. Namaste. I would like to begin today's session by quoting a Sanskrit shloka that goes, Na chaurahariyam, na charajahariyam, na patrubajam, na chabarakari. Vaye krite vardata eva nityam, vidyadhanas, sarvada pradhanam. Which means, knowledge is that wealth which cannot be stolen by thieves. Neither can it be taken away by kings, nor can it be divided between brothers. It is that wealth, when spent, reaps maximum benefits. Wealth of knowledge can fetch all riches in the world. Today, we have gathered here for the same. We have gathered here to gather the knowledge of wealth. Sorry, wealth of knowledge. Thus, in the name of Almighty, let's begin the second day of the two-day International Faculty Development Program organized by the Department of English, SSMRV College and IQSE Initiative. I am Harshita URS, Assistant Professor, Department of English, SSMRV College, who will be managing today's session. Well, on that note, I would repeat the instructions that were told prior. Kindly keep your audio and video mute and reserve your questions until the end of the event. First of all, I would like to welcome today's resource person, Mr. Imran Mulla, who has been kind enough to accept our invitation. A warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you very much.
I would like to welcome someone who believes procrastination is a curse. Like Kabir's Doha, he keeps pressing on the fact, kal kare so aaj kar, aaj kare so ab, pal mein pralay hoegi, bauri karega kab. He's someone who has been consistently encouraging youngsters like us to take baby steps in organizing international events. He is none other than our beloved principal, sir, Dr. S. Anil Kumar. Sir, I respectfully welcome you.
Thank you.
I welcome Dr. M. S. Nagaraj, the head, Department of Commerce and coordinator, IQSE, who joins us along with members of IQSE, Assistant Professor Gokul, Assistant Professor Shakila, and Assistant Professor Shiv Kumar. A hearty welcome to all of you, sir.
Thank you, madam.
I must mention the efforts of Mrs. Saujanya Diwan, the head, Department of English, and from pillar to post in making this faculty development program a reality. A warm welcome to you, madam.
Thank you, Harshita.
I welcome my fellow colleagues in the department, Assistant Professor Sindhu Shri NS and Assistant Professor David Sunil, who have joined us. Welcome you both. I feel privileged to welcome all the members of RV family, and I would also like to welcome the August gathering. It is the exuberance in registration that we have crossed 1,000 plus, and that has kept us highly spirited and enthusiastic. I welcome the esteemed gathering who are eagerly waiting to engage with us in the knowledge sharing exercise. I welcome one and all present here. I now request Dr. S. SSMRV College to address the gathering. Sir, over to you, please.
Hello, sir, you're muted.
Okay. I'm very happy to come back again on the second day of the international seminar organized by Department of English, SSMRV College, on a very important topic, the contribution of English literature for the social commitment. Yesterday we had, and today we have a great source of management lessons by a great speaker for today's program, Professor Imran Mulla, a visiting scholar, Cambridge University, United Kingdom. So very, very happy to welcome you once again, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes. SSMRV, I don't again want to tell you more about SSMRV. Yesterday I have spoken to you about SSMRV. One thing I would like to tell about the participants, more than 1,000. We have crossed 1,000 participants, and from about 300 institutions all over India, from 28 states. I think that is something amazing, which is happening in this particular program. And all this because of the kind of resource person we have with us today, Professor Imran Mulla. And I also appreciate the initiative taken by the Department of English and IQAC together in organizing this particular program. And I congratulate all the people who are involved in this initiative. And once again, I welcome all the participants who have joined today. I think there are about 250 already joined, and remaining others, the recorded version of this will be
kindly excuse the technical glitch. We will get back. 1 minute. Please give us a moment, please.
Yes, there is some internet issue. Okay, so I would like to wish the program a success. Thank you. Thank you once again. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the kind words you've bestowed on us. You being amidst us, we are delighted to have you, sir. Moving on. I would now call upon Professor David Sunil, Assistant Professor, to introduce our guest speaker for the day, Mr. Imran Mulla, to the August gathering. Professor David, please. Yes, sir.
I find it extremely difficult to summarize someone's potential with mere words alone. Nevertheless, it is the only way. Good evening to everyone present here. I, David Sunil, Assistant Professor of the Department of English, SSMRV College, have been given this opportunity to welcome our exuberant guest speaker, Sir Imran Mulla, for this International Faculty Development Program organized by the Department of English in association with IQAC. Professor Imran Mulla is a visiting fellow to the Department of English, University of Cambridge, United Kingdom. He is currently working as an assistant professor in KLE Society's SSMS College, Athani, and a research candidate in the Department of Study in English, Karnataka University, Dharwad, India. Sir has completed his master's in English from the Karnataka University, Dharwad, and was a lecturer in the prestigious Karnataka Arts College, teaching the postgraduate courses for 3 years from 2015 to 2018. And has also cleared NET. At the present moment, Sir is in his third year of research and specializes in the area of gendered violence in South Asian literature and the Shakespearean adaptations in Indian cinema. His focus is on the reception of Shakespeare in India and how Indian filmmakers use Shakespearean plays to tell uncomfortable stories. Sir is also an active member of the Chitra Film Society in Dharwad, which was set up by the notable playwright Girish Karnad. The idea behind the society is to introduce award-winning national and international films to the people and create a platform for the up-and-coming filmmakers to interact with famous directors and producers. We welcome you, sir, for this faculty development program. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, David, sir, for that kind introduction. We all are at the mercy of, the lords of Zoom and Google Meet. So please, you have to forgive me if there are any technical glitches coming in the future minutes of this talk or this presentation. I would like to thank the principal, Dr. S. Anil Kumar, sir, for giving head and giving his nod for this special faculty development program. And I have to thank the IQAC coordinator, Dr. Nagra sir, for being a part and parcel of this. And finally, I would like to thank Saujanya for thinking of me when she was planning this event with the administration and with the management. I have to thank the other fellows, colleagues and the members, teaching members of the college for being a part of this function. Before I continue, is my voice?
Excuse me, sir. Yes, sir. You have to be a little louder. No, sir. You have to be a little louder. You're audible, but it is a little low. So if you could increase the volume, it would be very.
Okay. How about now?
Fine, sir.
Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Perfect.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, I'm still getting a lot of messages where, it's okay now. Okay. Thank you so much. I have to mention
sorry
that...
to interrupt, Imran, one second. It's an humble request to all the participants, please mute your audio and video, please.
You can go ahead, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir. So I have to mention that both Sojin and I, are the students of Doru sir, who was here with us yesterday and who gave a very, interesting talk on literature and the connection with the social commitment that it has. So what I'm what I will be doing today is I will be looking at literature on one hand, and I will also be looking at what are the lessons, particularly what are the management lessons that literature combines together to form a new way of understanding our thoughts, not just about society, but also about the organization, about culture, about society, as well as individuals. And by doing so, what I try to establish here is, I will look at the various factors which are governed by this, by the management lessons through literature. So yesterday, Donu sir began with how we look at literature and what is the kind of commitment that is required by it. And he begins with Plato, Aristotle, Socrates on the same line. I will begin this talk by looking at how the ancient thinkers of our times have devoted themselves in understanding what and how this can be achieved through various literatures. Okay, so I think I'm now going to share my screen. And I hope so that this is in some way very helpful in understanding and okay, I'm just trying to share my screen now. There appears to be some kind of a technical glitch with my laptop here.
So maybe you'll have to increase the volume, sir. Volume of the device. That would be better, I suppose.
I'm on full volume here on my device. Yeah, the headset is, you know, it's at, 100%.
Okay, so you continue.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm still getting a lot of messages that it is not audible. Okay, I guess I'll just continue with this. All right. Okay. So this is a message, or this is a talk where we look at, literature as well as management, and what are the lessons that you can get out of this. All right. So many management gurus, they believe that, leadership and the lessons in the management are just like, society, where society should always be focused on improving the quality of life for both the individual and community as a whole. So all the organizations need effective and ethical executives that can lead them with technical knowledge and a humanistic touch. Leadership is about motivating, it is about equipping and training people. There are many lessons from literature and liberal arts that can shed insights into human conscious conscience, into human consciousness, and provide practical real world advice for lifting a person or a team's vision, improving their performance and building the overall potential of this. So when I make this statement, the first example that comes in our mind is that of Bhagavad Gita, where one person who makes it, who makes a difference in that particular situation, in that particular mode, is of course, Lord Krishna, who advises Arjuna of what he should be doing, and without bothering about the consequences of what his actions do. So in the same way, there are several Western intellectuals, management gurus, who look at ancient epics, and they try to bring out the management lessons, the qualities of leadership from these ancient texts, religious texts, and so on. So in the same way, when you look at literature, it has that similar essence in it. But when I say the word literature, I do not mean by all the literature that is available in front of you, or only a select few. And through this talk, I will be looking at these select few literatures that make a difference. Firstly, they say that management is about human beings. Its task is to make people capable of joint performance, to make their strengths effective and their weakness irrelevant. Second, when you look at the authors, the writers, they do that because they deal with the integration of people in common venture, and it is deeply embedded in culture. So when you look and we talk of management and leadership, these are the two faces of one coin, and they are similar in nature. And though they are similar, but their intentions are quite different. So one such person who comes to my mind is Peter Drucker, who is considered to be the father of modern management. So in both essence, management and leadership, like I said, are the sides of the same coin. Both are needed in different ways for any organization. So what do? They make us grow and contribute to the greater good of the society. As a matter of fact, management focuses on the process while leadership focuses on people. So therefore, leadership is the heart of management, and thus it is also the heart of liberal art. So because management deals with people, it deals with their values, their growth and development, this makes it humanity. Management is thus what tradition used to call a liberal art. Liberal because it deals with fundamentals of knowledge, self-knowledge, wisdom, and leadership. Art of the liberal art focuses, because of its practice and application. So when you look, if you go to Wharton School of Business or Harvard Business School or Judge Business School in Cambridge or Said's Business School in Oxford, they draw on the on the knowledge and insights of humanities and social science, on psychology, philosophy, economics, history, ethics, as well as on the discipline and practice through which humanities again acquire recognition, impact, and relevance. So therefore, managers and leaders are transformational change agents for society. So their responsibility extends beyond their organizations and into the world where people are, where life happens. So hence, the first part of my talk is titled as Leaders Are Readers. So this is one very good quote or an adage or a proverb that should be ringing in our minds throughout our life. So leaders are readers. So people create culture and culture creates societies. So culture consists of the shared values, beliefs, worldviews, accepted behaviors among a specific group. So traditionally, the most common outlet for expressing a culture came in the form of stories. And hence, stories are very important for us. Why? Because through stories, people show their innovativeness, they show their imagination, they show their adaptive, human beings are adaptive creatures. So any reflection on the work of, history's most influential writers is worth considering. Reading the famous stories, narratives of the past is a great way to analyze the present as well as plan for the future. Therefore, literature has much to teach executives about effectiveness, leadership, and of course about management. So as the proverb goes, or the adage goes, that leaders are readers. So anyone desiring to lead effectively will not only commit to hours of studying the trends of industries or organizations, global economy, etc., but it also signifies a small percentage of time in enriching ourselves through reading. So a serious reflection of topics outside one's domain or one's discipline is relevant to a culture of consumers and contributors that will improve our leadership performance. So when I say about leadership performance and when I say about management lessons, this does not only mean to a MBA graduate, or this does not mean only to a chartered accountant, or this does not mean to any CFOs or CEOs of companies, but it also means to every single one of us. the principal of the college, he should or he has to be a good leader. The IQAC coordinator has to be a good leader. The head of the department has to be a good leader. So this is what I mean by leadership performance. And when you look at various articles and literature that is all around you, you have to think about why this is better than consuming innumerable amount of data that is that should be present with us. So what do the literature do to us? What is the role of that literature? So in a recent, I came across this podcast recently, where the title of the podcast was Read Fiction and Be a Better Leader. So this was a podcast from Harvard Business School. It was on a blog. And Harvard Business School professor Joseph Bodaraco, he is the one who is pioneering this, this technique of introducing literature in his management classes. So one person who is trying to do a similar kind of role in Indian management schools and in colleges is Professor S. Manikutif. He first worked in IIM Ahmedabad, and then he later came back to where he was a professor emeritus in IIM Bangalore. So he does the same thing. So how do you understand this literature and how do you understand the essence of management through literature? So he says, what makes literature so valuable in the classroom is that it helps students really get inside individuals who are making decisions. And that's because the inner life of the characters is imagined and described in many cases by brilliant authors and writers whose sense of how people really think and how they really work and how their work has been tested by time over decades or even centuries. So the first, apart from the ancient literature, the ancient epics and religious texts, the one person who comes to our mind, or specifically my mind, when talking about literature and management lessons is Cervantes, and his other one is Don Quixote. So in the same manner, he talks indirectly about the management lessons. He shows what should be the qualities of a leader. So it is more emotional in nature, it involves psychology, and it involves self-discipline and focus. So these are these are very large, complex, theories, sometimes a very messy sphere of things that are very original and genuinely ethical. So through this notion or through this idea, the qualities of leadership as a human endeavor is a reality that is often absent in any other leadership qualities. These qualities may be flawed. So leadership and management lessons are a struggle by flawed human beings to make some important human values which are real and effective in the world as it is. So it might be a novel, it might be fiction, it might be narratives, it might be biographies, autobiographies, it might be n number of events. Through these narratives, people learn about themselves and others through reading the lives of various characters. With this understanding of what leadership can learn from liberal arts and literature, the remaining talk which I'm about to give now looks at classical stories from Western world's most influential fictional writers. So we'll be looking at William Shakespeare, who of course is considered to be the bard of English literature. We'll also be looking at John Steinbeck, who is considered to be one of the greatest American writer in American literature. And we'll be looking at George Bernard Shaw, another British writer as well as a dramatist and a very good public orator. So instead of retelling these stories, so I'll be giving out the themes with which we will be analyzing and then comparing to what Peter Drucker or what Joseph Borodako tries to do in their management lessons. I have to be very honest here, and I have to say that I was fortunate enough to meet Professor Joseph Borodako in University of Cambridge, last year. I did not knew that he was Joseph Borodako, but he was giving a talk on Shakespeare and the character of Shakespeare's in business ethics. So he was talking about Macbeth, he was talking about Othello, he was talking about all the flaws that we come across Shakespeare's characters. Now Shakespeare is one such writer whom everyone should know. When I say no, I mean you have to read and you have to watch Shakespeare's plays, irrespective of whether you're coming or whether your discipline and domain is from management, engineering, medical, or whatever it may be. So everyone should know Shakespeare. Why? Not just because of literature, but because of his essence of capturing human emotions. So like I said in my beginning of the class, that when you look at human emotions is always synonymous with management lessons and leadership qualities. So when we look at Shakespeare's characters, Shakespeare's plays, so it is very easy to get to know what the person or what this particular person is thinking, what is he doing. Various emotions are painted in this white and free canvas of Shakespeare's plays. So the second part of the talk is William Shakespeare and the fall of charismatic leaders. All right. So the second, this is the second part of my talk, that is William Shakespeare and the fall of charismatic leaders. So this is a very famous quotation comes to my mind. The desire for charisma is a political death wish. What matters is not charisma. What matters is whether the leader leads in the right direction or misleads. So there are some management gurus who consider persons or personalities of charisma as a personality trait is not that important quality in a human being, or in fact in leadership. So instead of focusing on exhibiting this dynamic personality, we should be able to account ourselves on responsibility, transparency, and accountability. So these are the three pillars with which management lessons are to be erected: responsibility, transparency, and accountability. So the three most, if you have to consider, okay, let us consider, if we have to consider a charismatic quality in a human being, so that to the top of my mind, who are the most charismatic leaders that come to my mind? The first one is, of course, is Adolf Hitler, The second one is Joseph Stalin, and third one is Mao, kind of a Chinese dictator. All right. So these were the three most charismatic leaders, of the time gone by. Hope so. So these men were not leaders, but they were rather misleaders. Much like Shakespeare's stories, of Julius Caesar and Macbeth, when leaders are consumed with their ego, their ability to equip their people fails. So I'm going to repeat this sentence. Considering the two plays, Shakespeare's two tragedies, historical plays, that is Macbeth and Julius Caesar, when leaders are consumed by their ego, their ability to equip their people fails. Leadership then becomes about maintaining a position of power instead of empowering others. An unhealthy account of charisma can lead to narcissism, much like the Greek myth of Narcissus, for whom the sin of vanity is named from. Many like him find their faith in tragic death. All right. So this is a kind of correlation that exists between any leader who has charisma as a quality in him or in her. So let us take the example of Julius Caesar. So in a very short, matter of time, or I will be giving a small description about what Julius Caesar is. Especially when we consider the story of Julius Caesar, okay, synonymous with the qualities of a leader or management lessons, keeping both together, weighing together, it is about a man, of course, Julius Caesar, who ruled Rome, and more about how his arrogant and charismatic personality was potentially the character flaw that led to his untimely death, which leads to a civil war in Rome and the beginning of the end of the world's most powerful empire, that is the Roman Empire. All right. So this is a small gist of what Julius Caesar is about by Shakespeare. Now, Julius Caesar is, of course, not a fictional story that William Shakespeare makes up. This is the story, which goes back to several centuries ago, before Christ. And this talks about the greatest empire that this world has ever seen, that is Roman Empire. And we have a leader here whose management lessons are completely flawed because of his quality of being a charismatic leader. Yes, he is very courageous. He is very brave. He is, in fact, one of the most celebrated army generals in the Roman army, legions of army. But as a leader, he is not fit to become a true leader of the Roman Empire. So when technically Rome was still considered to be a republic, Caesar had the ultimate say. Why? Because people liked him. So please try to connect this with what I had said earlier about the leaders who have the charismatic personality in them, Hitler, Joseph Stalin, and Mao of China. So he had the ultimate say. And though the, looking, since it was a republic, so most of the Senate members were not interested in having Caesar as their leader. They wanted to look and they wanted to save the Roman Empire as a republic state. And hence they planned to assassinate him, they planned to murder him, they planned to kill him. The conspirators who plotted his murder did not approve of his authoritative style. Many in Rome loved him, yes, and for that, they loved him for the joy that he gave people. Nonetheless, to this, Shakespeare's, interpretation, Caesar's death was a result of his own haughtiness. It is rare that conceit produces conscience in leadership. Another one of the management gurus by the name of William Cohen has a very a very interesting book titled Seven Deadly Sins of Leadership. So he considers sin of pride to be the worst of the sins. He says that it is a problem that comes when leaders believe themselves so special that ordinary rules are no longer applied to them. All right, so this is a most tragic sentence that I can read on this virtual platform here. So when they have this pride in them, when the leaders have pride in them, one of the most important management lessons that comes out of this particular drama or this particular play titled Julius Caesar is, when you have the pride in you, you believe and you start thinking that ordinary rules no longer apply to you. And that itself is the, that is where everything starts collapsing. And I should also mention, the poem by W.B. Yeats, The Second Coming. And I should mention how Chinua Achebe, a very brilliant African writer, through his novel Things Fall Apart, captures this essence of pride through his novel Things Fall Apart, and of course with W.B. Yeats in his poem The Second Coming. Turning and turning in the widening gyre, the falcon cannot hear the falcon. All right, so things fall apart. That's a very interesting phrase. That comes in our mind. So there was one question here that just popped up on my screen saying that how can you call Hitler as a charismatic leader? I will answer to this question at the end of my talk. That's a very interesting question, and I hoped that someone would be able to catch this and question me about this. All right, so thank you so much. I'll be answering that question at the end of my talk. So when we look at this pride as a sin, so which constitutes to be one of the important management lessons, so sometimes pride is considered as opposed to being proud of specific things, is the most serious leadership issue or sin, because it can lead to the other six. So as I said, there are seven deadly sins, and if you catch hold of this one sin, that is pride, automatically all the other sins are attached to you. So you keep falling prey to one sin after the other. So sometimes even the perception of what the leader does while committing this sin will make things far worse. For example, look at the country of Brazil today. All right, so we had they had a very interesting human being as their prime minister, Jair Bolsonaro. All right, again, he was a very charismatic leader. All right, and few years down the line, if you just go to Google and you type the political issues in Brazil right now, so people are on the streets demanding who should be held accountable for the deaths because of the COVID pandemic. Where is food? Where is the water? Where is the hospital? Where is the medical services that you promised you would deliver to us, right when you became the leader of our country? So everything is connected here. All right, so this was certainly the case with Julius Caesar also. So when he had that pride in him, his victories in the political arena and battlefield gave him a lot of pride that led to his belief that he was invincible and even divine. So when you read the play or when you watch the play, it is available in the YouTube, you can watch it. So the first scene begins where people are celebrating the victory of Julius Caesar, where he has defeated the former ruler of Rome, Pompey. And people are decorating the streets, people are chanting his name, they are shouting his name, there is so much of celebration going around. So we see two state senate members who are just walking the streets of Roman Empire, of Rome, and they say that this might lead to a very tragic end, because when you have pride in you, it makes you invincible. And that was the case of Julius Caesar. All right. So one of it's a very dangerous sin. All right. So unfortunately, this also led to his downfall. All right. So the people whom he trusted, they themselves, cross his paths because he was filled with pride, right? Which for the other Senate members, they felt that he is becoming invincible and he will be the worst dictator of our times. And hence they take matter into their own hands, and hence, the death of Julius Caesar. So looking, when I was, researching for this talk, one important book that came up, and which I hope is read by all of us is Alan Axelrod's book titled Julius Caesar CEO. All right. So he takes a step further and he looks at Julius Caesar as one of the potential CEO. All right. And what he has to say about this is, so when we look at the language, when I say language, I mean how the person speaks, right? What is his vocabulary? If you go to IIM, Bangalore, there are some professors who are very, very simple in their approach towards their class. We feel as if we are talking to our own friend, we are talking to our own personal, our own, family members. But there are some professors who just take you beyond your imagination, who take you beyond your ability to think, where they talk with such beautiful language, such beautiful vocabulary, that you feel as if you're in some other domain, you're in some other realm, where someone is teaching you very politely and using all these beautiful words. So if language is considered to be a measure of, or the standard of leadership, Julius Caesar, as an example, he sets a cross-cultural and pan-historical standard of leadership, right? In order to understand this point, you should know Julius Caesar. You should read, Shakespeare's play, Julius Caesar. So what happens at the end, right? What is the, moral story of the life and the death of Julius Caesar? Right now, as soon as he was assassinated and to the present times, the name Caesar is always synonym. Synonym with ruler. So Caesar equals ruler. So that is how powerful the stories are, and that is how powerful the narratives are. Where something which has happened 500 years ago, 700 years ago, 1,000 years ago, a few centuries ago, they come back to us in our present times and they keep knocking on our door to tell us that, see, this has what has happened in the past. don't repeat it again in the present. All right. So this was, you know, one of the lessons that I thought would make a difference, with Julius Caesar. And another important example that I would like to consider here is of Macbeth. All right. So Macbeth, just like Macbeth, just like Julius Caesar, he also meets the same fate as Julius Caesar. All right. So he mirrors the bloody assassination of Caesar and also the corruption of power in leadership and management. All right. So a gist of Macbeth. So Macbeth is, the story takes place in Scotland, right? So again, Macbeth, just like Julius Caesar, is considered to be the greatest general in the Scottish army, all right? So he's a Scottish thane, he's consumed with pride and ambition, all right? So he's consumed with pride and ambition. So as you start reading the play, and when you look, even if you look at the movie, which was very beautifully portrayed by a Hollywood actor, Michael Fassbender, all right? So the opening shot begins with Macbeth riding his horse and a very huge sword in his hand. And you can see the pride and ambition in his eyes, in his personality, all right? Because he has won the war for his king. So he's filled with the pride, and people, who are surrounding him, they're actually afraid of Macbeth. I'm not saying they respect him, but they are actually afraid of Macbeth. Why? Because of the two reasons and because of the two examples that I gave you earlier. One is the language with which the person talks, and the other one is with how his personality defines his, conduct. So when Macbeth walks, he walks with such, a pride in his gait, that people do not want to disturb him. They do not want to disturb him. So he's consumed with pride and ambition, so much so that as soon as he wins the war for the king, he believes that why shouldn't I become the king? And hence he kills the king of Scotland, whose name is Duncan in the play. And he assumes the crown. So so once he becomes in charge, once he becomes the king, so Macbeth becomes incredibly obsessed with keeping his rule that he disregards any morality, right? So he's so obsessed with this power that he does not trust anyone, he does not want to believe anyone, and for that matter, he disregards any morality. So that is the one of the side effects, or maybe the only side effect, of having pride in you. So he's power hungry and paranoid at the both, both at the same time. And that, according to many philosophers, including Sigmund Freud, is a very dangerous combination, all right? So you are hungry for power. At the same time, you're also very paranoid about it. So what does he do? He ends up having anyone who threatens his kingdom killed, right? So that is what he does, right? Anyone who speaks against him, or anyone who threatens him, is removed and is killed instantly. So again, it was the charisma and pride that led to the fall of once great leader. And make no doubt that Julius Caesar and Macbeth are both very good characters. They are well written, they are well crafted, and people like them. All right, like them to such an extent that they respect them. All right, but as a human being, they fall short you know, in few inches when we talk about them being on a whole map as, you know, good human beings. So going again back to what William Cohen says, it is, you know, that component or the warning which keeps on repeating itself. So that requires to lead and motivate the workers to, you know, peak performance. All right. So this type of leadership is what is called as transformational leadership, as opposed to the traditional tyrannical type of transactional leadership, right? So this was the examples from William Shakespeare. So when we look at John Steinbeck, the American writer, very prolific American writer. So the third part of my talk is titled as The Meaning of Work, W-O-R-K, The Meaning of Work. So, I would have quoted and I would have, talked about, this meaning of work through, through the works of, through the teachings of Chanakya, through the teachings of, Baswanna, through the teachings of so many Sanskrit scholars of our times. But what I felt, why did I select John Steinbeck? Steinbeck is because what we are witnessing, in our contemporary issues. All right. So John Steinbeck, through his work, he became a very popular writer because of his, minute details about poverty and how poverty affects humans, all right? And he wrote his novels, his two important novels, at the time of in the times of the Great Depression in America in the late 1920s and early till 1930s, all right? It is perhaps the biggest job of the modern corporation to find a synthesis between justice and dignity, between equality of opportunities and social status and function. So what we have to understand is we have to understand the importance of work and find meaning in work to improve not only the human conditions at the individual level, but also in the community, all right? So this is another important management lesson that we get from the literature of John Steinbeck, through his novels, all right? So work provides achievement and to some degree, an identity. Every one of us present in this virtual platform here, we are represented here by our work. All right, so we are represented here by our work, and that work has given us an identity. All right, so it might be any type of work. It might be a manual labor in a field or among the knowledge workers. All right, so when I say the word knowledge workers, I tend to mean it in inverted commas. All right. When I say knowledge workers, there are particular themes and functions which are associated with this. So when we look at society, the functioning of a society, like productivity and managerial responsibility, they are at the same level, all right? Almost similar to that of district collector is doing, and what a team leader of a particular in any multinational company or a tech company is doing there. All right, so they both have the level of productivity as well as responsibility. So the first example from John Steinbeck's work is Grapes of Wrath, All right, The Grapes of Wrath. So this novel is about about a family, Toad. So this presents a historical analysis of the political and economic revolution that is taking place in the United States of America, all right, during the 1930s, of course, which is nothing but the the Great Depression. So what are the main themes with which we identify management lessons through this particular work? All right, so first one is a man's inhumanity to his fellow human beings or to his fellow brethren. All right, when we look at our neighbors, when you look at anyone who is around us, look at the present scenario here. All right, in Bangalore, every part of the world, particularly in India, for the past 1.5 months. All right, even if I wanted to help my neighbor, I could not. All right, even if I wanted to help my my high school teachers, my college teachers, I could not. Why is this? Because this talks about our inhumanity to our fellow human beings. So we have one of the major themes of this particular novel is impoverished leadership structure, the saving power of family and friends in difficult times, in hardships, and the role of dignity in our work. All right, so this fictional family, though it is fictional, right, it is not entirely true. All right, it is a fictional story. This fictional family, the Jodes, J-O-A-D-S, Jodes, who are driven from the land in Oklahoma and represent the thousands of families who struggled during the Great Depression. So we can only deny social status and function to the economically unsuccessful if we are convinced that a lack of economic success is, first, always a person's a person's own fault, and the second one is a reliable indication of his or her worthlessness as a human personality and as a citizen. All right, so the novel that I'm talking about is The Grapes of Wrath. Okay, grapes usually spelled wrath, w-r-a-t-h, The Grapes of Wrath. All right, again, this has a biblical reference. The title of the novel has a biblical reference to it. All right, it refers to the Bible, the biblical reference. All right, I won't go into into the details of it. All right, so it reflects to our contemporary times, where when you talk about the management lesson that we get out of this particular novel is the inability of human personality and as a citizen. All right, so we can compare this to a society that brings citizens together, or we can compare this with a society that differentiates citizens altogether. Right, so the choice is left to the individuals, whether you want to bring the citizens of the society, of the nation, of the state together, or whether you want to differentiate the citizens of a state. So it combines, this particular novel combines lessons both from politics as well as economics. So while presenting management as the essential element needed to produce effectiveness both inside and outside the company, all right, and hence I chose John Steinbeck's novel, The Grapes of Wrath, as a very good source of understanding this particular lesson in our contemporary times and in our contemporary issue. The second such example of John Steinbeck's novel that I have chosen for this particular talk is of mice and men. Mice usually spelled as it is spelled M-I-C-E, mice and men. So just like Grapes of Wrath, Steinbeck addresses again the issue of economic and social issues of again the 1930s of the Great Depression. So the previous novel, The Grapes of Wrath, it dealt primarily with public administration and discrimination. It dealt with this horrendous discrimination that is done because of the economic status of the society. The second novel, that is Of Mice and Men, so that it shows the concern of loneliness that is resulted from general labor as a hired farm hand. All right, so this particular character here, two characters, all right, George and Lenny, they have lost their lands, and in order to fill in order to kill their hunger, they readily agree to work in someone's farm. All right, so the story focuses on these two characters, all right, the migrant working couple, George and Lenny. So, and these two are very odd couple, all right. So George is a smaller man, but has very sharp perception, all right, though he's very short, but he has a very sharp perception. While Lenny is very large and has a mental disability. So George looks after Lenny, and the two are working to save up to buy their own farm. And while George laments over taking care of Lenny, he knows Lenny is the only friend he has. It is in an unfortunate string of events, Lenny accidentally kills a woman, and George is forced to shoot Lenny in order to save him from the torture of an angry farm mob. All right. So this has a very tragic ending to it. All right. But this talks about one of the most important management lessons that we can savor in this novel. That is the importance of being loneliness. All right. And how you should take your your members, your team, your friends together for a common good, or for the cause of a common good. All right. So what do people people look at resources rather than problem, and that leads them to control, to have this very messy control of relationships, which are very critical in establishing leadership effectiveness. All right. So that becomes a very crucial and a very important lesson for us all. All right, irrespective of the individuals, we have to take each other as one whole unit and move forward. So the final part of my talk talks about George Bernard Shaw, and the title of what I call this, the last part of my talk, is Man's Continual Improvement. All right. So people with knowledge must take responsibility for their own development and placement. So it is in us that we have to reinvent ourselves again and again. So when we look at George Bernard Shaw's play Man and Superman, so it takes this typical story of adaptations in hope of desiring the perfect male specimen through preceding generations. So intellectual, social, and cultural stages are applied in this physical desire of humans. I would not like to call this man's continual improvement, but humans' continual improvement, where it is dependent on your intellectual, your social, as well as your cultural standing. So tying this with the themes of Shakespeare, together with that of John Steinbeck, Shaw's plays, Man and Superman, they are philosophical in nature, and they are gifted enough to be exceptionally capable of distinguishing between good and evil. So they follow their own instincts without regard to the common common law, and therefore, while gaining the ardent sympathy of rebellious instincts, which is very dangerous for a managerial responsibility or a managerial leader, all right? So facing the rebellious instincts, all right? So through this work, Man and Superman, George Bernard Shaw shows us the moral conflict with which our existing institutions come to our rescue. And which are those? Those are our intellectual, our social standing, as well as our cultural standing. So this particular play by George Bernard Shaw, Man and Superman, it confronts leadership lessons, management lessons, such as sacrificial love, continuous improvement, and completing a mission through a set of objectives. And the second example that I would like to give of George Bernard Shaw is Arms and the Man. So this this play has the same thematic elements of the previous play. All right. Again, the philosophical issues concerning social issues, specifically war. All right. So I remember Fyodor Dostoevsky's a letter to one of his friends, where he says that how do you understand the human conditions? How do you understand the human brilliance? When does it come out? Where does it come out? So when you look at Russian literature, I'm not talking about European literature, I'm just talking about Russian literature. All right. So Russian literature, for example, Fyodor Dostoevsky, The Brothers Karamazov, and Crime and Punishment. All right. So when you look at these two works of Fyodor Dostoevsky, these works tell you that man reaches his highest capabilities when he is in dire need or when he is in dire consequences. All right. So take this idea, this notion, and try to test it with what Sigmund Freud says in his psychoanalysis, all right, about human beings' idea of gaining knowledge and accessing that knowledge. All right, that is very important. All right, so that also becomes one of the most important management lessons. All right, how do we access that knowledge which is inside us? That itself, is a journey which requires, I'm afraid, which requires a lot of sacrifices. So when we look at this particular play, Arms and the Man, so this talks about the atrocities of war, resulting, of course, from dictatorship. It talks about thriving on power over people. And through this particular work, what George Bernard Shaw, or what we can look as one of the management lessons is, we can try to look for solution from preventing the tyranny of misleadership. So the alternative to autonomous institutions that function and perform is not freedom, all right? That definitely cannot be freedom. It is a totalitarian tyranny. And tyranny, is not just the resting face towards destruction, but as an entity, it itself provides an opportunity for those charismatic leaders to thrive on people through power. So this particular play, it talks about improvement, it talks about autonomy based on the societal level. All right. So in conclusion, all I can say is, when you look at management lessons, the management foundation is to be built on the responsible leaders. Responsible leaders who are ready to take the responsibility for making life better for both the individual as well as the society. So this happens in part through accountability, performance, and measurable results. But having a skilled leader, or a skilled hand and enlightened head are not enough. Leaders need to have a heart for their people. And it is through this, supplement of humanistic insights from fiction literature that our leaders will be able to raise their people's vision, improve performance, and increase an organization's potential. Thank you so much for giving me this time to bring forth my ideas. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your insights and inputs on management lessons and literature. Your quote that you were quoting from W.B. Yeats, "The falcon cannot hear the falconer," that is, the human race has lost its human instincts, is truly inspiring. So I must admit, your charismatic presentation is lauded by the academia and the people added here. You were truly wonderful and adorable. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Well, our participants have a few questions, sir. If you don't mind, yes. I'm going to put forth just three questions and then we're going to close the session. Is that fine, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So there is Mrinal C. Minal who is asking, sir, you have rendered exemplifications for charismatic Shakespearean characters who met the doom. So she's referring to, I suppose, Julius Caesar and Macbeth. And then she's asking, the context of Richard III is different from both these examples. Can you please comment? Is the question from Mrinal C. Minal. Mrinal C. Minal. Yeah.
Okay. So why, I think Richard III, differs from Julius Caesar as well as Macbeth or even Othello, for example. Because though he is considered to be charismatic, but if you read the play intently, he does not abide by anyone's rules. All right, he has his own way of looking at things. He has his own way of trying to justify each and everything. Maybe for example, it might be, if you take the example of how he deals with the French, kingdom, or with the French, rulers, and how he deals with his own problems at domestic level. He presents himself to be a man who listens to everyone, but he does what he feels is best for him as well as the state. And hence, I feel he differs from Caesar, Julius Caesar, and of course as Macbeth.
Oh, well, the next question is from Gopika Kulkarni. She says, sir, can you please throw light upon literary works literary works in managing this great pandemic with reference to Black Death or the Plague by Albert Camus? So she's referring to Corona and the
date
of plague.
Okay. Does she want me to recommend any books from this?
I'm not sure, sir. She's not mentioned that. She's just asking you to compare.
Okay. She wants me to compare.
Yes, sir.
With
Corona, with that of plague or Black Death.
Okay. I think French literature, especially when we take the example of Albert Camus, the individual perception and insight is more important compared to working as a whole. All right. Even if you take the example of Camus' The Stranger, or even if you take the example, like you said, the play by Albert Camus. I feel, French literature, French people, they're always very, they want, everything to be around them. And hence I feel Albert Camus, though he's talking about, all this happening around him, but that ill happening is shown through an individual's perception. Okay, so perspective becomes very important when we talk about French literature, and especially when we talk about Albert Camus as a writer of big difference. All right, I hope that satisfies the answer.
Yes, sir. There's one other question. It says it is from Ashwini Reddy. She says, "How is loneliness a management skill? Could you please explain this with reference to the text of Mice and Man?" Men.
So when I'll be very honest, when I was thinking of considering John Steinbeck's novel of Mice and Men, okay, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so when we talk about John Steinbeck and Of Mice and Men, so I deliberately took this as an example because I wanted to show that even in most difficult times, sometimes you have to act on your own. So through that particular example of the characters George and Lenny, all right, George is he's very resistant in doing what he does at the end, though tragic it may sound, but if he hadn't done it, the consequences would have been more tragic in nature. All right, so remember, we are talking about United States of America, where there were laws such as Jim Crow laws, all right, and there were something, the laws were very harsh, right, and it was because of the Great Depression that farmers were contemplating suicide, all right, which is quite similar in any country, not just in India. Let us not talk about just India, let us talk about America, let us talk about European countries, let us talk about what is happening in Russia, let us talk about what is happening in various parts of the world, all right? So when difficult times come knocking on our door, we have to take these drastic steps, and this is what the characters do. Loneliness here becomes very important because they have no one else, and no one else is ready to come to their rescue. Everyone is fighting their respective wars, so they do not have anyone else. They have to, pull up their socks, and they have to be ready for whatever comes in front of them. And for that reason, I have chosen. I took the risk of gambling this with John Steinbeck's novel Of Mice and Men. I hope I have answered your question.
So, if you remember, you had promised Margaret Zion to answer.
Thank you so much.
The question was, let me repeat it to this people, the audience who have just come in. So Margaret Zion had asked, "Sir, how can you call Hitler as a charismatic leader?" So please throw your opinion on this, sir.
Okay, I will be giving you three features or characteristics of three different leaders. All right. Okay, so everyone, I hope, is paying attention. So the first leader. So the first leader is an alcoholic. He consumes drugs. He is a womanizer. And before sleeping, he has to gulp down a bottle of champagne. That is the first. Second leader, he has committed various crimes. He has broken laws many times. He has married couple of times, all right, and he's not a pleasant person to work with. This is the second leader. The third one is he drinks occasionally, only half a glass of wine on special occasions. He respects women. He never consumes any drugs. He wakes up early in the morning. He goes to sleep very early at the night. He's a voracious reader. And of course, he is considered to be the leader of the people. So among these three people, whom will you choose as your leader? Of course, most of us will say that the third example of a leader that he will choose. That was no one else but Adolf Hitler. All right, the other two persons were, the last reference was of Hitler. The first person was of, Kennedy and the, not actually Kennedy, of Winston Churchill. The second one was of Winston Churchill. All right. So why do I say charismatic leader? Is because he appeared to fill, he appeared very, pious. All right. So if you look at the documentaries of Second World War, he walks with such pride, you can almost sense it, all right? You can almost see it. There's nothing much to decipher of how he is as a person, all right? And why do I call him charismatic leader is because of his, look at where Mercedes is, look at the automobile industry, look at the, look at the way in which, science and technology, progressed during his time. All right. Even if you go to many of the management schools, all right, his autobiography, Mein Kampf, is one of the books that they try to analyze or read, right? And hence I call him a charismatic leader for that reason. Right. There's so much to say, but I'm limiting myself. All right.
So, sir, you can go on. With you, but due to paucity of time, dear participants, it's time we draw curtains to today's session. Thank you all for participating in our two-day International Faculty Development Program. SSM Mavi College is truly indebted to all of you present here. Thank you, one and all. But before the formal closure, I now call upon Mrs. Saujanya Diwan, Head, Department of English, to present the closing remarks and propose the vote of thanks. But before a formal closure, I request the participants to fill in the feedback form and join us on our social media platforms like Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn, etc. Wishing Sarve Jana Sukhino Bhavantu, this is Harshita, you are signing off. Thank you, one and all. Over to Mrs. Saujanya Diwan. Thank you.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, very much.
Yeah. So, I, Saujanya Diwan, Head Department of English, and an event coordinator, I'm asked to give closing remarks as well as to propose the vote of thanks. So, to start with, management and leadership are the two faces of a single coin, as mentioned by Professor Imran. He has made sure to talk about Peter Drucker, who is the most influential management thinker ever. He has also enlightened us by mentioning that managers should, above all else, be leaders. It's an art of getting things done through and with people in formally organized groups. Also, one cannot build on weakness to achieve results. One has to use all the available strengths. Professor Imran also added that a great literature makes changes in us and that stays changed. Of course, the most celebrated writer, William Shakespeare, and his essence of capturing human emotions was just remarkable, which also connects to the management lessons as well. The three important aspects of management, responsibility, pervasive dynamics, that are also seen in the works of literature, as mentioned, Julius Caesar as CEO. To summarize, Professor Imran has engrossed on several subjects as philosophy, economics, politics, and definitely management that connects the literary society. Thank you, Imran. Thank you so much for your valuable words.
Thank you.
Yeah. So to thank everyone, I would like to start with our first day guest speaker, Dr. Basavaraj P. Donur, Professor and Head Department of English, Central University, Karnataka, Kalburgi. That was a very thoughtful session. Thank you so much, sir. And I would like to thank our today's guest speaker, Professor Imran Mullah. Thank you for your wonderful session, Imran.
Thank you.
Not failing to thank our own Honorable Principal, sir, Dr. S. Anil Kumar, sir, very supportive. Our organizing team, Dr. M.S. Nagaraj, sir, Head, Department of Commerce, Coordinator, IQSE, Assistant Professor, Dr. Gokul, Department of Commerce, Member, IQSE, Assistant Professor Shakila, Department of Commerce, Assistant Professor Shivakumara, Department of Commerce, my team, Assistant Professor Harshita, Department of English, Assistant Professor Sindhushree, Department of English, and Assistant Professor David Sunil, Department of English, scholars, all the participants from various countries, states, within SSMRV, various heads of department, coordinators, class teachers, teaching and non-teaching faculties. Thank you so much for making this session and very thoughtful and wonderful. Thank you so much. Harshita?
Hello. Thank you so much, participants. Please do, we'll keep you posted. Please do connect with us for all the social media updates through WhatsApp and all our social pages which are across. We'll be updating you on these videos too. Thank you, Imran sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Very productive evening for all of us. Thank you, sir. In case some of your colleagues or friends have not been able to join the session, please let them know that in an hour's time it will be uploaded to YouTube. That link will also be sent to your WhatsApp group so they can catch up on that. Sir, people are asking your email ID and your contact details, probably if you don't mind sharing it.
I think I'll just use the chat box and
Yes, sir, you can type in there.
Okay. Okay, so this is
If you could, yeah. Either way, sir, no problem. You can tell me, I can type it. Otherwise, it's.
And this is my phone number.
Perfect.
Okay.
Yes. Sir has given his email ID and his mobile number. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much.
Please stay connected with us.
Thank you, everyone. Yes, thank you, Imran.
Thank you, sir.
And so the participants can now leave the group and let us join for the next event. Thank you so much.
Thank you.